Last fall, the Boston Red Sox didn't just become World Series champions. They became a phenomenon. The bushy beards, the free-spirited approach, the way they uplifted their city in the wake of the Boston Marathon bombings. Even Yankees fans were impressed. Now, spring training has arrived, and the boys are back. I spoke with three of the players who make up the heart of that Red Sox clubhouse, Johnny Gomes, Mike Napoli, and David Ross. What is it like to be all back together again?
You know, as cliche as it sounds, I mean, it was like being away from your family for 4 months. It was good to be back in the little, you know, the little safety nest that we built.
You seem so close.
I'll be talking to these guys, you know, hopefully when I'm 70, if they're still alive.
I will be. Your manager, John Farrell, said that he had to do a little bit of a double take, though, when he walked back in the clubhouse, especially seeing the difference. We got the side-by-side of Johnny here of this.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, this is not the same person when you look at the side-by-side photos.
Right. Well, it was free agency year, you know, so
I had to shave
some years off, you know. So, yeah, the whole thing was a setup.
Did anybody have to say, wait, I don't quite recognize you?
Yeah, I had to pick him up the first day. And I was driving, I couldn't even look at him. And I wanted to talk to him, but I think I was driving and looking out the side of my eye to look at him. It was just different.
You didn't shave. You trimmed a little bit, but you didn't shave.
I mean, I like it. I don't know. It's just, it's part of me. And I mean, I don't think I have a wife like these guys. You know,
I did shed a tear when I cut mine off. I was like, man, what did I just do? It was a lot of work to get that thing where it was.
Do you think if you hit a rough patch in the season, maybe the beards are going to start to come out again?
No, I mean, there's a couple rough patches with the beard, you know? We didn't, you know, want to take it off, but...
My career is a rough patch.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I tell you what, at the end of the day, you know, I mean, it is time to turn the page on the beard. I mean, there are some great athletes and ballplayers behind these beards.
You guys had so many reasons to need the beards for Team Unity, to have those things to bring you guys together. And then, of course, the Boston Marathon bombing so early in the season. Remember about that day and how the news kind of filtered to you?
First thing that came to my mind, you know, somebody left the gas on, or you know, there was an explosion or an electrical box blew up. Everyone's on the bus. We didn't, you know, trying to call our families. You know, we didn't know what was going on. Cell phone's not working. It was just a weird feeling. We didn't really know what to do.
We had two buses going this way and then just getting passed by fire trucks and ambulances and police cars.
You guys were heading out to Cleveland.
We were going
to
Cleveland. And obviously the bombing explosion, and now we're getting on an airplane. You know, the one thing that you fear the most if you're in the air.
And then by the time we got to Cleveland, I've never seen as quick of a turnaround of a group of guys. I mean, the responsibility that we felt as a team to come together and, hey, this is a tough time. Let's go out here and show them what the Red Sox are all about. What, you know, let's represent Boston in the right way.
You guys represent Boston in such an intrinsic way, and the fact that you were there day after day. Baseball happens every day. You were something reliable that people could hold on to.
We were going out there to, you know, do something good so they'd get their minds off it for a couple hours.
I mean, I thought there was a good chance after that bombing, like, you know, civilian coming to the game, like, oh, I don't want to go to the game. It's not safe. You know, I mean, that thing was just packed right out there. That Northeast, that Boston area, they don't shy away from anything.
And after you guys won, of course, one of the great traditions in Boston, the Duck Boat Parade. And you laid down at the marathon finish line that trophy.
Yeah, I mean, that was, unbelievable. There's not many, you know, championship parades that, you know, come to a halt. You know, the fact that we put that World Series trophy kind of, put a Band-Aid on that area and the bad thoughts. I mean, now people can walk to that area and be like, that's where we put the World Series trophy versus that's where the bomb went off, you know. So I think that was extremely important for
and
the
it,
city.
It was a moment that during all the celebration and all the parade and everybody screaming for us, everything stopped. Like Johnny said, this is what it's really all about. This is how important this was to us.
And you guys are going to be playing again when they run the Boston Marathon again in just a few weeks from now. It's a tradition in Boston, Patriots Day. They run the marathon, the Red Sox play. That's how tied up you guys are in that event.
What do you think that's going to be like?
It's going to be a lot. Yeah. It's definitely going to be a lot. I know for me personally, I'm about as the non-runner of any of the guys on the team. And if I wasn't playing baseball, I would want to run. That's how I feel tied to this city and this marathon now. I would want to be a part of what's going to go on there.
Last season, these guys helped engineer one of the greatest turnarounds in the history of baseball, winning the World Series with a team that the previous year had finished dead last in its division. Hey, maybe that's why they were celebrating so hard.
So what is it like in the aftermath of a World Series win?
I didn't come down for the longest time. I was like, will you get your feet back on the ground? And I'm like, no, I don't want to either.
You're tasting food from 3 weeks ago.
Yeah. Yes.
We had some fun talk show appearances.
Thank you, Red Sox first baseman Mike Napoli, for walking around Boston shirtless after the World Series parade, thereby earning your new nickname, Mike Nipoli.
No mention of this would be complete without Mike, who wandered the streets of Boston after hours without a shirt.
I mean, I'd do it again.
We hope he does it.
Right.
Him than one us, because we might have been naked.
That's how the text messages started. We're just, hey, right. is Mike alive? Let's just make sure Nav's okay.
It was a good month after the season, for sure.
Is Mike Nipoli going to catch on, you think, or what?
You picked the nickname. I want the player. Right.
Yeah. Do you guys think there's been a little bit of a culture change in baseball because of your team last year?
I think so. I mean, they're still not talking about our pitching staff. You know what I mean? They're still not.
You know, it's just ironic how that team worked out last year to where we didn't have one guy in the top 10 of the Cy Young and one guy in the top 10 of the MVP, but we had the best team. And, you know, at the end of the day, I think it was all, you know, a message to us and a message to the league that works. You know, that works 100%.
All right, so as you now go out in the world and try to do this again, you know that the record is not good. The World Series hangover. No Red Sox team has made it back there after winning the year before.
We're the second team in the history of the game to go from worst to win the World Series. So we've already covered almost impossible. I mean, to be able to roll into spring training with, you know, the worst record in the AL East and set a goal to win the World Series, it's either stupid or you guys are awesome. It turns out we're awesome. So, you know, the impossible has taken away, so I think we're up for the challenge.